Today we have a wonderful talk. It's a surprise talk since we don't have the title. And let's see. I know that this. Oh, so I was not prepared enough. Okay, so yeah, this I remembered, but I remembered the speaker, but not the name of the. Of the talk. So Moritz Gerstner today is speaking about synchronization and desynchronization in the epilepsy, so controversies and hypotheses. So let's go on, the floor is yours.
Thank you for the introduction. So let us start with a quote. For several instants, I experience a happiness that is impossible in an ordinary state, and of which other people have no conception. I feel full harmony in myself and in the whole world, and the feeling is so strong and sweet that for a few seconds of such bliss, one could give up 10 years of life, perhaps all of life. This quote is from the Russian writer Fyodor Dostoevsky, who is probably one of the most famous epileptics. Epilepsy is a disorder characterized by seizures, but what is a seizure? This is the main question of my talk. Right before a seizure occurs, many epileptics experience a perceptual disturbance called aura, during which they have strong visual, auditory, or psychic sensations. This aura is what Dostoevsky tries to describe in his quote. Let us continue. I felt that heaven descended to earth and swallowed me. I really attained God and was imbued with him. All of you healthy people don't even suspect what happiness is. That happiness that we epileptics experience for a second before an attack. So, my talk is structured in three parts. In the first part, I will try to explain what a seizure is. In the second part, I will evaluate the network science of seizures and ask the question, why do epileptics have seizures and healthy people do not? And at the end, I will talk about chimera states and their relationship to seizures. So let's start, what is a seizure? If we ask that question, we should look up the medical definition of a seizure, and it says, an epileptic seizure is a transient occurrence of signs and or symptoms due to abnormal excessive or synchronous neuronal activity in the brain. Of all seizures, 60% are convulsive and 40% are non-convulsive. To diagnose seizures, we usually use EEG, which consists of electrodes which are placed on the participant's head, and those electrodes measure voltage changes that are produced by the action potentials in the brain. A normal EEG of 16 electrodes would look like this, so we have some low amplitude, low frequency activity. Doing a non-convulsive seizure, we see some high amplitude, low frequency activity. And doing a convulsive seizure, we have high amplitude and high frequency activity. And it is difficult to recognize any patterns in there. So to answer the question what a seizure is, I will present some experimental results from which I have from a review article from the group of Sziruska and Schindler. And the data they considered are mainly from rat brains, in which they investigated rats, we have here the brain, and the data that we will examine first consists of two electrodes. One was placed in the entorhinal cortex and the other one was placed in the hippocampus. This is the data of those two electrodes. This is before the seizure occurs, this is the seizure, and this is after the seizure. So what we see is that we have, well, if we recall our definition of excessive and synchronous neuronal activity, we see easily the excessive part of the definition. As soon as the seizure starts, the voltage changes increase rapidly. And we can also see some synchronicity because the amplitude of the voltage changes is synchronously modulated for both electrodes. But what about those on the small time scale, those small spikes, are those synchronous too? To evaluate that, we calculate the cross correlation in which our two functions f and g correspond to the two signals. And if we take the complex conjugate of the function and multiply it with the second signal with the time shift tau and evaluate the integral, we obtain the cross correlation. So here we have different shifts of tau, and the larger the overlap of the two functions, the larger our integral becomes, the larger our cross correlation is. So if we look at the beginning of this, before the seizure occurs, we have a cross correlation of about 50%. Then when the seizure occurs, we have a cross correlation of more than 80%. And at the end of the seizure, we again have a cross correlation of around 80%. We can notice though that B, C and D look quite different, which shows us that a seizure is not one continuous state, but it actually shows some dynamics that change. If we want to know what changes between C and D, about which frequencies are coherent, we should calculate the coherency for each frequency. So to do that, we calculate the cross-spectral density, which is the Fourier transform of the cross-correlation. And then we take this cross-spectral density, take the absolute and square it, and divide by the order spectral densities of both signals, and then we obtain the coherency for each frequency. If we now plot the coherency over the frequency before the seizure occurs, we find a peak in the low alpha and delta range, and then little coherence for the rest of the frequencies. During the seizure, we find a very high coherence for basically all frequencies. And at the end of the seizure, we see still very high coherence, but the higher frequencies start to decorrelate. Note that even the low frequencies, which are less coherent, are still as coherent as in the healthy state. So coming back to our definition of abnormal excessive or synchronous neural activity in the brain, it makes a lot of sense. This is now data from a human, and where electrodes were placed in the left temporal pole and the left hippocampus, which is the memory area inside the brain. And here we have again the activity before the seizure occurs, and here we have the seizure. If we now plot the cross correlation over time, we expect a small cross correlation in the healthy state and a high cross correlation in the seizure state. And what we find is pretty much exactly this: small correlation, high correlation. However, what is interesting is what happens right here in the transition from the healthy to the seizure state. What we find is a large decrease in correlation right before the seizure occurs. This is a very counterintuitive finding, and I cannot give you a satisfying explanation why it is like that, but we will later come back to a group of researchers who were able to simulate this result. Now we move one step up in complexity and consider 9 electrodes, which were still obtained from rat brains. And you can see that the first electrodes measures first the seizure, and then more and more electrodes measure the seizure activity. We cannot calculate the cross correlation for more than two functions, so now we need a new measurement, which is called the global synchronization index. And to obtain it, we call all those channels Z1 to Z9, we have M channels. We have T time points, so all our data consists of the Zi channels for each time point Tk. And then we normalize the data by subtracting the mean and dividing by the standard deviation. We put these normalized data in our equal time correlation matrix, which consists of the, as in the columns and row of rows of the channels, and is divided by the number of time points. And then, because of the normalization, all entries range between minus 1 and 1. 1 means perfect correlation, minus 1 anti-correlation, and 0 means no correlation. And our matrix will have diagonal elements which are always 1, because every signal perfectly correlates with itself. It will show symmetry, the entries are real, and it's diagonalizable. So next, we compute the eigenvectors and eigenvalues. The maximum eigenvalue gives us information about the synchronization. If we have m channels and the system is completely synchronized, the maximum eigenvalue will be equal to m. But we want our index to be independent of the number of channels, so we normalize it such that the maximum eigenvalue ranges between 0 and 1. And this will be our global synchronization index. If we now plot this global synchronization index for those 9 electrodes, and if we remember our definition of a seizure, what we expect is that the synchronization increases as more and more electrodes start to participate in the seizure. We expect that it then reaches its peak when all electrodes are seizing, that it will stay constant, and at the end of the seizure it will go back to 0. But what we find instead is this. We see that the global synchronization index increases, then it decreases again, increases, here it goes back to 0, it reaches some peak, goes back, decreases, increases, reaches some minimum, then reaches basically its highest value at the end of the seizure, and then it goes back to 0. Now if we look at those data and at the global synchronization index, we cannot really understand what is going on there. But the great thing about the eigenvalues is they do not only give us information about the synchronization, but also about the clusters of synchronization. And this is called the participation index. The eth element of the eigenvector k, vik squared, gives the contribution of each channel I to the cluster k. So by combining the eigenvectors and eigenvalues, we obtain the different clusters of synchronization. If we plot this participation coefficient, we find that we have here a large cluster of synchronization, and interestingly, those electrodes above, which corresponds to those ones, are not synchronized with that cluster. Our calculation tells us that there's actually a second cluster of synchronization, which looks like this. And if we compare them, we see that they are basically pretty much the opposite. And with this participation index, we can now understand what is going on here. We have more and more electrodes that start to synchronize. Then basically all of the electrodes are synchronized in the same cluster. This is our peak. Then, however, a second cluster emerges, which is not synchronized with this cluster. And this is why the index decreases again. At the end, all electrodes are seizing in the same cluster again. And then we reach the highest value. And then the seizure is over. If we now again come back to our definition, we realize that the definition might be a little bit misleading, because when we think of synchronicity of neuronal activity in the brain during a seizure, we might think that all neurons participating in the seizures are all spiking coherently at one frequency in the same phase. But we just saw that there can actually be different clusters of synchronization with different frequencies in different phases. To summarize, when we are examining small data sets, our definition makes a lot of sense. When we move up in complexity one step, our definition is still pretty good, but it starts to be a little bit misleading. And now I'm going to cheat and tell you something that I will not show you until the end of the talk. If we are considering large-scale human data, then we realize that not only synchronization, but also its opposite, desynchronization, becomes an important part of the seizure. And then our definition becomes even more blurry as we reach the highest complexity. Defining epileptic seizures becomes more difficult with increasing complexity of the data. Now I will talk about the network science of seizures. And at this point I wanted to play a video, which will probably not work. So I can possibly show the video at the end of the lecture when I connect my own notebook. In this video, we are seeing an epileptic seizure of a patient. And the next question that I want to answer is, why does this patient have seizures, and why do most of us do not have seizures? What's basically the difference between his network and our network? And if we are considering the network science of epilepsy, we can answer what the differences are that causes seizures. This article is from the group of Chavez et al. That was published in Physical Review Letters. And as a method, they used MEG, which works similar to EEG, and it measures the action potentials in the brain, but not by measuring the voltage changes, but instead by measuring the magnetic fields. We need at least 100,000 action potentials flowing in the same direction to be able to measure them, and this will be in the range of 100 femtoteslas. We again measure the linear coherence that we know already, which consists of the cross-spectral density absolute squared of the two signals and the two autospectral densities, and thereby we create a functional weighted brain network. So we're not examining anatomical structural connections, such we would attain from diffusion tensor imaging, for example, but in this case we are considering functional network by looking which brain areas are coherent. The node strength tells us the number of weights that attaches to one node, so the node strength of A would be, for example, 4 plus 2, and the node strength of the control group turns out to be an average around 4, whereas for the epileptic patients, it's nearly twice as large with a value of around 7. The weighted clustering coefficient tells us, if we're considering friend networks, for example, how likely my friends know each other. So if this was a friend network and I was V, I had a low or a zero clustering coefficient because my friends don't know each other. In that network, I had a high clustering coefficient because my friends are likely to know each other. The weighted clustering coefficient of the control group was 0.2, and of the epileptic group was again statistically significant higher with 0.3. The efficiency of a graph tells us how efficiently information can be exchanged in a network. So we have here a clustered ring topology in which the nodes are connected to its neighbors. So we have high clustering but a low efficiency because information has to travel all the way to the opposite node, for example. In this random network we have no clustering and a very high efficiency because the path lengths from node I to node J are very short. And this would be a small world network which shows both high clustering and high efficiency due to some shortcuts. The global efficiency gives us the fraction of the efficiency of a network divided by the best possible efficiency of the network. And it turns out that the control group has a global efficiency of around 65%, and the epileptic group has an efficiency of nearly 90%. It's also interesting to investigate the modularity of brain networks. A module is a subset of units within a network such that connections between them are denser than connections with the rest of the network. So in that case we had three modules because the connections within the module are more dense than the connections with the rest of the network. These are the modules that the researchers identified for the control group and for the patients. It turns out that the control group has actually more modules than the patients. The within module degree Z score tells us how likely one node I is connected to other nodes in the same module. And when we compare those, in that case we don't see big differences. The patients show us a little bit higher values here in the red zone, but they also show lower values in the blue area. So in both cases the groups were pretty similar. So we might think that this could be the healthy network and this could be the patient network because of the higher clustering. But this is not true because, as we just saw from the within module degree Z score, the within module connections between the patients and the control group was similar. The participation coefficient, however, tells us how well nodes are connected to nodes in other modules. And here it turns out that we find strong differences. The patients show an average much higher values of the participation coefficient than the control group. So this means if we are considering those model networks, the patient network would probably look like this because it has much stronger connections between those modules. And this might be an explanation why epileptic patients are more likely to suffer from seizures. To summarize, if we compare patients versus control, we find a richer node connectivity, higher clustering, a higher efficiency, and we find fewer modules which are more densely connected. At this point, I should mention, of course, that there are also other differences between epileptic patients and healthy controls, not only the network properties, there are also differences on the cellular level of ion channels, membranes, and neurotransmitters, but this is probably an important difference for many of the epileptics that suffer from seizures. So now I will talk about chimera states and how they are related to epilepsy. The main question is, are epileptic seizures collapses of chimera states? So let us define what a chimera state is. A chimera state is a spatiotemporal pattern of identical coupled oscillators which spontaneously break into two groups, one exhibiting coherent motion and another incoherent. So if this is a system of 500 oscillators and those are the different phases, then we find one coherent group that has the same frequency and the same phase, and we find one incoherent group which shows randomly distributed phases. If we remember our diagram from the Jiruska paper, we might think that we have a chimera state here because this cluster is synchronized, whereas this cluster is not, so we could think that this would be the incoherent group. But as we have seen, this is not true because the second cluster is also synchronized. So then rather having one coherent group and one incoherent group, we have in that case two coherent groups, so this is not a chimera state. The group of Andresiak et al., however, and Schindler claim that they have indeed found empirical evidence for chimera states in epilepsy, and they simulated a network of identical non-locally coupled oscillators, and they found chimera states, observed how they collapsed, and compared those to seizures. This is actually the only paper in the scientific literature that claims to have empirical evidence for this relationship. There are also other papers discussing this, but they are considering simulated data, not empirical one. In the model, the oscillation frequency is given by the natural frequency and the coupling kernel, in which alpha is the phase lag parameter. We see here the different phases of the system, and we have here some nice chimera states with the incoherent group in the middle and the coherent group on the top and the bottom, and here the chimera state collapses. If we now look at the frequencies of the oscillation frequencies, it looks pretty similar, and the Kuramoto order parameter is calculated here, but only for the low coherence group, for the incoherent oscillators, and for its next 10 neighbors only. So what we see here is when we take the average of the order parameter and plot it here, that right before the system synchronizes and reaches perfect order basically, we find again a strong desynchronization, which is really counterintuitive, and this is again basically the lowest order is achieved on a large time scale right before the system synchronizes. And this is exactly what we have seen previously in those data. We have basically here the healthy state, here we have the seizure which corresponds to the synchronized state, and on this transition from healthy to seizure we find a strong decorrelation. This is a very interesting, remarkable finding, and it's very difficult to understand why it is like that. And it's also difficult to understand if somebody is having a seizure, what this decorrelation might feel like. Maybe this is this mysterious aura that Dostoevsky was talking about, but I'm going to let that open. However, the researchers did not try to confirm these data. They claim that they have their own evidence for this relationship. They investigated three patients which have surgically implanted electrodes that lie right on the surface of their cortex, which is called electrocorticography or intracranial EEG. What they found is this. They calculated for all those electrodes the time derivative and normalized it by subtracting the mean and dividing by the standard deviation. And whenever this value was larger than 7, they plotted those black lines in there. This is according to the authors the seizure activity. This is basically how they defined what a seizure is. The green dashed lines gives the onset of the seizure determined by visual inspection of the EEG, and the later green line gives the end of the seizure, also denoted by visual inspection. They calculated the cross correlation of the electrodes with its neighboring electrodes, and we know the cross correlation already. They normalized it again by subtracting the mean and dividing by the standard deviation. So red means that the electrodes measure synchronized activity, which is statistically significant, and blue means that the electrodes measure desynchronized activity, which is statistically significantly not synchronized. And this is the data from the second patient. Now, at this point, I have to admit that I am not completely sure what this data is supposed to tell us. If we remember this diagram with the blue and red, it kind of looks like a chimera state. It's kind of suggested by the colors. But the authors also kind of claim that the seizure is a collapse of a chimera state, which would mean that we would expect the chimera state before the seizure occurs and not during the seizure. And the author also found this desynchronization before the seizure occurs, which is also quite difficult to identify. So basically, I formulated what I did not understand in three questions that I will lead you through, and maybe you can help me to answer those questions at the end of the talk. The first question regards the desynchronization at the seizure onset. We have the synchronized state, which probably corresponds to the seizure, and the healthy, which might correspond to the chimera state, and here we have the onset. The authors do not explicitly state that this is how they see this. This was basically my interpretation, which might be wrong. In the abstract, the authors write, analyzing spatiotemporal correlation profiles derived from intracranial EEG of seizures, we found a pronounced decrease of decorrelation at seizure onsets. However, when I try to find this pronounced decrease of correlation, which should be blue, in the data, I see some of it here, which is prior to this seizure, but I also see some decorrelation in the middle of the seizure and some at the end of the seizure. And for the second patient, I see actually more decorrelation in the second half of the seizure than I see in the first half of the seizure. So what they mean by the pronounced decrease of correlation of the seizure onsets is something that I did not understand. My second question regards the timing of the chimera states. My interpretation was that a healthy state was a chimera state and the seizure was a synchronized state, which would mean that we are all having chimera states in our brain right now. Professor Schell suggested to me that maybe the chimera state is only the transition to the seizure, and then the seizure is the synchronized state, and the healthy state might be the desynchronized state. Anyways, if we believe that a seizure is the collapse of a chimera state, then we would expect something like this. We would expect that before the seizure occurs, we have a chimera state, coherent group and incoherent group. We then have, during the seizure, the synchronized state, which would be red, and then we have, after the seizure, a chimera state again. Well, what we get is this, which is basically something that looks a little bit like a chimera state, but not before the seizure occurs, but right during the seizure. So if we look at that, it looks a little bit as if a seizure was a chimera state, and not a collapse of a chimera state. However, the answer to this question might be that we are actually not seeing a chimera state. A chimera state is this, coherent group and incoherent group, and what we are seeing here would be more something like this, where we have some red, which means that we have a coherent group, we have a little bit of blue, which would be the incoherent groups, and then we have a lot of white, which means that the groups are basically neither really coherent nor really incoherent. However, the correlation is only calculated for its next neighbors, so we have no reason to believe that this red area was synchronized to this red area. And if you remember our diagram from the Juruska paper, we saw that during a seizure, we have a very high coherence for basically all frequencies. So rather than having one coherent group, we are probably having three different coherent groups, and then our result would be this. So my last question would be, is this a chimera state? And if not, then where is the connection to the chimera states? This is again something that I was not quite sure. These are data from three patients that the researchers published in the article. They've also investigated a third patient, which is found in the supplements, and he doesn't fit at all to the hypothesis of the researchers. He doesn't show any desynchronization at the seizure onset, and he also doesn't show any chimera-like behavior. He basically doesn't show any desynchronization. So I conclude whether chimera states are linked to epilepsy remains an open question. The researchers state in the discussion that this only represents a first link between chimera collapses and epileptic seizures. There is a growing number of real-world examples of chimera states, which indicates that they are of practical use. The brain, however, is by far the most complex system that we know. And yeah, basically everything we experience throughout our life is made up by our brain, and that's why I think it's so interesting to study it. But if we keep the research going, and if we collaborate with excellent neuroscientists, we might be able to find more links between chimera states and seizures. And then we could possibly benefit from our theoretical knowledge of chimera science and help epileptic patients by predicting their seizures before they occur, or even by terminating their seizures using neurostimulation. This is a long way to go, but I think for the knowledge and for the medical help of the patients, it would be worth it. Thank you for your attention.
For this wonderful talk, are there questions?
Thank you for this interesting talk. It shows that it's really very difficult to assess human data. First of all, there are only two or three subjects, so this is a very small sample, and variability in humans is huge. So variability between healthy and pathological states is really huge. And so the difficulty is that I think we cannot expect to get any quantitative or maybe even in some respects qualitative agreement between theory and the real experiment, the humans. And so what can we learn from all this? And this is maybe a question, what questions should one attack? I mean, I think it's hopeless to try and describe these three time traces of three individuals or two individuals by our simulations, but maybe we can dig up some underlying mechanisms. And as chimera states are a transition, one scenario, one possible, not the only possible. This morning we have discussed other possible scenarios like solitary scenarios. So one possible scenario leading from complete coherence to complete incoherence. But even that, I mean, in humans you will not have complete coherence and you will not have incomplete coherence. It's always something in between. So this is a comment, but it's also maybe a question to you and to all. What sort of questions should we ask? And I believe in simple models, but simple models can only explain simple phenomena and not the whole complexity of a human brain.
While we are waiting for help, you go, go. I just have a technical question or remarks regarding the participation index 1 and 2. So it is quite understandable that two different clusters are emerging. But do the authors who write some assumptions regarding the different role played by these parts of the brain, or they just assume that they have to be synchronous at any time? So in other words, maybe from my point of view, the things could be better explained, saying that there is a signal that flows from one part of the brain to the other. Maybe it starts from one part of the brain, then it flows, reaches or recruits other parts, and then that's why there are two different clusters, because the signal or the epilepsy, see, the epileptic seizure simply has a focus in one region and then it goes on and it propagates. So do they say something like this or not?
Well, yeah, to understand the dynamics of a seizure and how synchronization spreads from one area to a different one is very complicated, even if we only investigate 9 electrodes, which is a very small data set. And we can, I think by inspecting visually, we can see some flowing. I mean, it's not that there are some islands in which synchronicity appears and disappears, but instead we see how some seizure activity spreads here and then spreads in this area. And so there are some dynamics of how the seizure spreads through the brain. And I guess it's very, very difficult to evaluate it and to describe it. And I think this is also a large part of the seizure research. Also, if it's considered to stop seizures using neurostimulation, scientists ask which parts of the brain should we stimulate to stop the seizure. And from what I have read, this is very poorly understood at the current moment. And these data are from rat brains. They were they basically intoxicated the rats with a toxin called tetanus, and this causes seizures to occur. So it's also not 100% sure whether those seizures are actually perfectly the same seizures that epileptic patients have, but I guess it's probably still a good model that is interesting to study.
Two questions. Question number one, maybe missed it, but did they say anything, or did they... do we know whether there are certain areas that are like most inflicted of epilepsy in the brain? So do we know whether, like, I don't know, hypothalamus or something is synchronized with something else, or is it just nothing at all? And my second question would be, since I'm not really familiar with epilepsy, is there any phenomenological differences within the disease? So is there certain types of epilepsy so that we probably should concentrate on certain subtypes or something like that?
Yeah, this is a very good question, because actually, well, the first question, whether there are different brain areas which are more susceptible to develop an epilepsy, is that we can divide epilepsy in basically two groups: focal epilepsy, which means that the seizure is limited to one brain area. And then there's generalized epilepsy, which means that the entire brain is basically participating in the seizure. And the focal seizures can also spread and become a generalized seizure afterwards. And those focal seizures can have different sources in which they appear. Some people believe that Dostoevsky might have had a temporal lobe seizure, because they are very typical for those auras those patients perceive. And yeah, depending on different kind of auras patients have, also psychologists try to identify where the seizure comes from, and then of course they use EEG to better localize the regions. So there are many different focal areas where a seizure can develop, basically all parts of the brain, but some are more likely to develop seizures, like the temporal lobes, for example. And the second question was also very good, because there's actually a vast amount of different kind of epilepsy, of different kind of seizures. So many people say epilepsy is not a disorder, but it's actually a set of disorders, because there are so many different kind of seizures, and seizures with convulsions, seizures in which the opposite happens and all muscles relax, and seizures with loss of consciousness and only distorted consciousness, and all kind of seizures are basically existent. And about the three patients that showed very different behavior, the researchers also said when they show the third patient in the supplement section that they are not saying that for all kind of epilepsies and seizures that they would find the seizure synchronization prior to seizure onset. And to prove this point, they give a counterexample to show that the different case can be true too. However, in that case, I'm actually wondering why the researchers did not ask the doctors what kind of seizures the patient suffered from, because they're right before surgery, they have been under medical investigation for many years probably. So the researchers, the doctors, I mean, knew exactly which kind of seizures the patient suffered from. So I think the researchers should have made sure that they are only investigating data from the same kind of seizure.
I would simply also add that medical doctors usually believe that seizures are coming from some tumors or deformation of brain parts. So it depends on the tumor, it depends on which kind of the brain is affected, then you have different kind of effects. So it's not so easy to infer a general classification. Okay, there are...
I would like to come back to the higher efficiency. You had you contrasted epileptics versus healthy people, and there was one keyword, high efficiency. I would like to understand that. I didn't understand really what that efficiency measures and why is it higher for the pathological case.
Well, in the network, the efficiency always tells us if we want to exchange information how many nodes we have to pass to reach the target node, basically. And so I guess in those model networks, it's very easy to understand what the efficiency means. In the brain, this also means that the patient brain has more connections, and that's why one of the reasons why the efficiency is higher, because, for example, we have seen that the epileptics have more connections between the modules, and those additional connections might probably be enough to increase the efficiency, because then one node does not have to go all the way to this one node to is connected to the different module, but it can basically much more quickly can go to the different module by this connection. And this higher efficiency is then probably also a reason why, for example, a focal seizure might much more easily spread in an epileptic patient than in a control, because in higher efficiency means also, not only information can spread more quickly, but also seizures can spread more quickly.
If there are no other questions, let's ask thanks again the speaker, and thank you for coming, and see you next week.